You know, the funny thing, when I joined, I had no idea about PS4. And then when I met with Mark Cerny and he sort of walked me through all the details, I was like, oh my God, this is amazing. I mean, it really was something that he had built with the developer in mind. When I understood the vision, I was like, okay. We're onto something here. When I arrived, we did a few little tweaks to the organization. There's a lot of people that are really passionate about independent developers, and they were in the product evaluation group. So we moved them over into DevRel, developer relations, and said, okay, you now have a travel budget, go out there and do your thing. And guys like Nick Suttner and Shane Bettenhausen and Brian Silva were finally able to go out there and really sort of put some pep in their step and talk to, you know, the team's a lot bigger than that, but to go out there and talk to all the developers out there. People around the company wanted to do it, but it was kind of like they were in different groups. So we said, let's make this a thing. Let's build out this program and make it a big deal. So it became easy to say, hey, listen, we're for you because we get you, and we're flipping the table on all of our processes. We've got a lot of stuff we're not great at. We recognize that we're blowing it a little bit with developers, so let's fix that. My favorite thing is watching us all argue about content, about like, I like this, I like that. It's very interesting to see their taste sort of come through in what we go after, whether it's PubFund or different developers we're trying to get on stage and stuff like that. I think when we all get together, like it's all sort of a council when we bring in titles and stuff like that, their job is to go out and just facilitate developers to get on the platform, right? So in that process, there is no bias, right? It's like, what if you're a developer and you want to get on the platform, you're going to be assigned an account manager, and we've got Saul and Steve and Sarah and a large team that does all that. For PubFund stuff, obviously, they champion and find things that they're like, hey, I think this would be really great. And a lot of times that's where you have to sit back, listen to everyone's opinions. Sometimes I give my own, but a lot of times I just like, what do you guys think and what is the internet buzzing about? If the game's already come out or if the developers talked about it. But yeah, everyone's got their biases, you know, and it's fun to watch that stuff. Like I said, I just, whenever anyone brings me a game that looks like Black Tiger, I'm like, I'm in. Or Ultima 7, that was like my favorite game of all time. Unfortunately, I think with this job, there's a lot of the 9 to 5 is meetings, but a lot of the people on team, absolutely, they're watching Twitter on a regular basis, is sort of up in the background, so they're able to keep in touch with what's happening because information sort of travels so quickly. You know, I do my daily check-in with NeoGAF just to, you know, give myself a little bit of pain and suffering, a little bit of indigestion, see what they think. But I honestly think that when they break stuff and when they're talking about things, it helps us do our job better. Like if we're aware of what's happening in the social stratosphere, I can't believe I just said social stratosphere, but it's true, then it makes us do our job better because we're trying to bring great games to the platform. And if people are having frustrations or there's a bug or a patch that's needed and stuff like that, we want to jump on it quickly. So whenever there's great content on any platform, we're like, hey, why don't we give those guys a call? Or do we have a relationship with them? Or, you know, what's the skinny? I love that about it. It's like a race to find, to help developers, you know, and get them discovered and help them sort of promote their games. Well, I think previously, a few years ago, it was like, I can't self-publish. I don't want to work with a publisher. And we're like, no, you can self-publish. All that stuff's super easy. That's the big thing, is of getting them equipment, helping them through the process, and sort of allaying their worries. And if they ever have concerns about how difficult the process can be, or if we're talking about PubFund, then we often give them the contact information of all the people that have been through the process and got PubFunded, so they can talk to them directly. You know, of course, there's NDAs and stuff like that, but they can just be open to discuss it. I think that's the best way to approach the trust building, is say, I'm paid to, you know, to talk positively about what we do, but the reality is you got to talk to the people that make the stuff, and they'll tell you the straight truth. Yeah, I mean, we will too, but it sort of allows us to back up our story. Because of all the outreach and discussions that we have with all the different developers, it makes us better as a platform, right? They are more outspoken and more sort of honest with their feedback with us, so we're able to affect more change on the platform. And so I don't ever see that stopping. I don't see ever us not picking up the phone and being excited about a game that's come across the board. Now, when a game does blow up and become super successful, that's great. That's like a bonus, but it doesn't really affect the way in which we approach how we do our job. That team is more measured around the quality of the platform and how it's improving and evolving, and how our relationships and the public perception from the development community, more than just purely revenue. So it's sort of a mixed thing. You know, obviously we have strong relationships with our publishers as well, and they bring in a lot of revenue for the company. But our relationship with developers, we think, is driving the most amount of change. Well, step one is always, what are you guys working on as a publisher and as a studio? So we're always scouring, you know, the whole industry and saying, what are you guys working on? What's coming up? How's that coming along? And because we're one of the few platforms, of course, they usually give us sort of special access to talk about the future plans. And a lot of it sort of stems from chemistry. You know, how do you start the conversation? What do you care about? I remember first time they saw me, they showed us the glimmer about Destiny, and I just like stood up and I was like, oh my God, that's amazing. And they're like, I don't think anyone's ever stood up clapping in a meeting with us. And then there's the long drawn out conversation of how we're going to partner and how long it's going to be. You know, the Destiny partnership is a multi-year, really, really large partnership, which we're excited to talk more about down the road. But yeah, it's a long, long sort of lead conversation that we have ongoing with everyone. I mean, we're trying to plan out the next 2, 3, 4, 5 years of content. Hanging out with Lorne Lanning, that was sort of one of those things that I'd always loved to do. I've always been a fan of Playdead. Having Jonathan Blow out on stage at our February event was pretty great. The Supergiant stuff with Transistor was phenomenal. I have so much respect for that team. So on the indie front, it's been nothing but awesome. But the other thing I'm really proud of is our big partnerships with our publishers. Like getting Blizzard over to the console and with Diablo 3 and our partnership there was a huge feat. I think our relationship with Bungie has been phenomenal with Destiny. Going up there and meeting with Pete Parsons and the whole entire development team to walk through the process and see what they're cooking up, I think has been absolutely, that's been like dream come true stuff. Like walking through the halls of Bungie and working with them closely has been great. Relationship with Rockstar, I think just Bethesda cooking up the whole Elder Scrolls Online deal. That game was never planned to come to consoles. And we just kind of kept sitting with them and being like, why not? PS4 is, you know, as we're sort of disclosing the team and telling more about the details, I'm like, there's no reason. I love MMOs and I love Elder Scrolls. So I was like, why don't you do this? And they're like, we're not planning it. I'm like, well, what if we built a plan that we could do that? So getting that, knowing that a game's coming to the console that was never going to come to the console, that's the kind of stuff that is like, yes, you know, hugely awesome. It's been pretty exciting. I think a lot of people, you know, with the pro indie developer thing is like, yeah, it's a cool shtick, a cool story. Right. But the reality of it is it's super real. Like, it, when you sit with anyone on my team and you talk to them about what games they're playing and what they care about, and the guys here in Europe too, what they care about and what they're talking about, it's real. When great things happen to great people, I kind of well up a bit and get really excited about it because I was there, I've advocated for developers, I've been on that seat, and we are empowered by our company. We're allowed to give these people permission to succeed, and that's really, really amazing. To me, that's the whole thing, is it's not a story, it's not just an angle. You know, it's really, truly the strategy of PlayStation. Was that helpful?
Yes, for sure.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you so much.
All right.